trauma. Everyone has it. No one talks about it. It seems easier to stay silent, ignore it, or stuff it than it does to honor it, learn from it, and finally heal. Trauma is debilitating. Yet so often we suffer in silence. Trauma is not meant to be battled alone, and we are no longer going to suffer in silence. Together, we are creating a safe place to speak, to share our stories, and grow our strength as we heal. Together, we are giving a voice to those who have been silenced, bringing darkness into light, and letting God use our stories. Today, we find ourselves again. We relight our spark and let it light up the world. Stop CIS is a nonprofit organization dedicated to educating on issues of trauma and trafficking, as well as the amazing power of the healing journey. Welcome to Stop CIS. Hey, 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 you guys, welcome back to Stop CIS, Stop Suffering in Silence. My name is Denise Walsh. I am a clinical psychologist turned dream life coach, and I'm here with co-host Rachel Timothy, who is a trauma and trafficking survivor and more, which is what we're going to talk about today. So, Rachel, let's introduce the conversation that we want to have today. And we don't come even into the conversation with all of the answers, but we're interested in this conversation. So let's start there.
Yeah, so I was having a conversation with Granny not too long ago, and it just kind of got brought up of, you know, you're more than just your story. At what point does your day-to-day life expand on the other qualities that God has given you, the other areas of your life? Like, when are you doing things more than just sharing your story? Like, because you're more than that. And that question was, I don't know, like I kind of sat there stunned and thought, well, what else is there? And, you know, we chatted for it a bit and, you know, ended up ending the conversation really with no answers, because again, it was like, okay, I don't even know who I am outside of that.
So when we first met, you were in crisis mode, I would say. And you were kind of living in fight or flight. You didn't feel safe in your own home, in your own skin, like you didn't know who to trust. And so there was a lot of fear, living in fear. Mm-hmm. And so when we first met, the first goal was to, you know, as I say, like living in the world of that fear or drama or chaos, slowing that down. And that's fight or flight mode, where your blood goes from your brain to your limbs and you're in like fight mode, flight mode, freeze, all of that. And so the first goal was to slow that down and start living in rest and digest, which is the world of dreams, where you can hear yourself think, you start to reconnect with your intuition, you can hear your heart, you can start thinking like, what is my favorite color and what do I like to do? And you can start truly getting to know yourself again. So you've been living in more of what I would say a rest and digest phase. You're living in more peace. You are living with less overall anxiety. You feel safe in your own skin and in your home and with your relationships. Tell me about that shift, and then we can expand. Do you feel a difference?
I do feel a difference. Like, I guess I still have all of those things, but I have tools to combat them, I guess. And so I don't feel the chaos every single day with things. I feel like I am able to be a mom and a wife and a friend. And so I do feel a difference as far as my healing part has come. But again, like going back to who I am outside of all that, like we got, you know, our discussion was, what can I do to maybe start working? You know, we had the discussion of substitute teaching. And in my mind, it's like, okay, so what if I have a day of flashbacks or a day of anxiety? And well, then you just don't go that day because you're a sub. Well, what if I don't have it in the morning, but it comes in the afternoon? Well, then, you know, so I feel like, okay, what I can do is I can share my story. I can open blind eyes, and that's what I am passionate about. But what if there is more that I don't know of?
Yeah. Well, I think that's a really powerful question to ask yourself, because you couldn't ask yourself when you were living in crisis.
No.
But now that you've been on the healing journey and you've learned the tools and skills and you've shared your story and you've strengthened your voice, now you get to say, what else? What's next? And it's not even like you're leaving sharing your story and sharing the healing journey behind, because I think that will always be a piece of who you are. And it'll always be an impassioned part of who you are, right? That's that holy discontent of like, this has got to stop, you know, that kind of energy. Like
Yeah.
that will always be a piece of who you are. So
Yeah.
the question then becomes, what else do you like? What else do you
Yeah.
enjoy?
Like, I liked what you said when, I don't know if it was at the beginning of this or when we were not yet recording, but you said you're building off of it.
I don't know. I mean, at some, there may be some survivors who are like, I'm healed and I never need to talk about this again. Like, I've done my counseling, I've done the healing journey, I've gotten it out of my system and I never need to talk about it. But I don't know that that's you. And so the goal then would be, number one, you start talking about your healing journey too. You started just talking about your story. And then it was like, we've got more to share. So then you expanded that and started talking about the healing journey. So then again, as you expand again.
Yes, but share what we found in the process of me sharing my healing journey.
It's been interesting because, and I'm not surprised. I mean, clickbait and emotional, like people want the hard stuff. This is why true crime gets millions of views, right? Like people want to talk about the hard junk. And so the story, your story, gets a lot more attention than the healing journey. But
Yes.
both are important and both
Yeah.
are important pieces to share.
Well, I remember going back to a place where I have shared my story multiple times. And here it's like a year later, and I'm thinking, okay, this time I am going to get to share the healing journey. And I quickly found that's not necessarily what they wanted to hear. They were bringing in more people to hear the story of what I went through. And that's what they wanted me to focus on. And so it did, it kind of surprised me a little bit.
And I think it's the shock and awe of it. It's the
They don't want it to happen to anybody they know. And I get that. Like, I want to help that. That's like a huge part of my passion. And I, but it's interesting too, because back when, oh, years ago, I was still struggling so much. I took a course called Elevate Academy, I believe, and it's with Rebecca Bender. And the whole purpose of it is, you know, you work through your trauma, and they have support groups, and they have leaders who you can talk to one-on-one, and they have books and they have classes. And it's a basically this progression of healing that you go through in this academy. But the end result is professions all surrounded your story, whether you want to write your story, you want to speak your story, you want to work at a safe house, you want to work with a trafficking organization that rescue, it was all still surrounded with your story because that's what we know the most.
Well, and what I find is as people move through healing, they want to support people who are three steps behind them, you
Yeah,
know? And so you'll hear
natural.
people say, I experienced this and I want to make sure nobody else goes through that. Or I want to help the little girl who's hurting just like I was. And then so it makes sense that then you would choose professions. I mean, how many of our survivors now want to be counselors or coaches or
Yes.
create the space to support others on their healing journey too.
Well, and it also feels like there's purpose for your pain. Like, your pain wasn't just a section of your life that felt destructive. It literally has led you to where you have purpose bigger than yourself.
So all of that is empowering.
Yeah. Yes, it is empowering. And it's kind of like you saying, I want to stick it to these guys. Like what you thought would take me out, I'm now using to get others out.
And so when you hear, all right, Rachel, what else are you about? What comes to mind?
I mean, I a mom and a wife and a friend. But I mean, my depth is more so in my story. Like that's what I know.
So another thing I've seen you do is art and graphic design,
Yes.
creating.
Yeah. And one of the things that, when Granny and I were having this conversation that prompted in my own heart was, I do want to write more. And I don't want to just write about my story. I have a lot of other things in there. A lot of other things God has showed me. So there is a desire to write. Now, I do think it still stems from pieces that I've learned or that have helped me. But don't we all do that somewhat? If you're passionate about your job, it's a piece of who you are.
That's the thing. I don't think that it's a, I think it's really that, like we mentioned, a layering where you say, all right, what else? Now that I've, at first sharing your story was super hard and you were curled up in a ball and, it took a lot of emotion out of you, right? Well, now, I mean, I think we've got, I can think of three or four speaking engagements through the rest of the year. And so it's become, I mean, podcasts, all these things. So it has become easier for you to share your story and speak your truth and have your voice. And so now we get to expand your comfort zone again and, add another layer to who Rachel Timothy is and what she's all about.
Yeah. And I think even having relationships, having friendships where maybe they don't know that piece necessarily, or they only know a little bit. They don't have to know just how broken everything was a few years ago. But I just get to be a quote unquote friend, a mom friend, a whatever. I don't really have that, which is interesting. Like it's, a lot of my wit and again, like this is just kind of the season I think I'm somewhat in, but I mean, my friends are survivors.
Right. And in your church community, and they know.
Yeah, they do know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about people at the pool? Any friends there?
Well, but they know my story. They know what's going on, and yeah,
Okay.
but still, it's there's acquaintances that don't know.
Yeah. Yep. And I think you'll have.
Because it's hard to navigate. It's hard to because I don't want to, I don't know, that I want to use what God has given me. I want to use for good what they meant for evil, but at the same time, I don't want to be all consumed with it. And that's hard.
So, substitute teaching, art. What else are you interested in?
Writing.
Children's books? Regular,
I
like,
have thought about that. I have. I actually have thought about writing a series of children's books related, with the main character being Nash, my dog, and having it be like encouragement based or, biblically based or something to encourage kids. But yeah, I have thought about that.
That's super cool. So I'm thinking of you expanding, your layers and adding another hobby, adding another job. I mean, obviously, you being a mom is taking you outside of your own story because you're focused on them. And so your whole summer is based on like, what do they need and what's going on at home and all of that kind of stuff. So you certainly have times in your day where you're not thinking about your story or your healing journey or how you can give back to this community. But it seems like creating more times in your day to have brain space for other things would be helpful.
I think that's what it is. It's all about my thoughts and what's owning my thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah. And so if we were to talk about art or substitute teaching or starting to write books that are not about a survivor story, what would you want to do first?
Well, I'm kind of writing one right now.
Oh, tell me more.
Yeah, I don't know. I've started studying about spiritual warfare and what that actually looks like. You know, as I'm going through my own court case and things like that, like I'm really interested in tapping into everything and anything that I can for the strength that I need for this court case. And so I've been studying more about spiritual warfare, which took me to the book of Ephesians, which then made me want to write about things in the book of Ephesians and how we can apply it to our life. And so I've started writing about that.
Okay. So this is more of like a devotional.
And notice my nervous hands. That is uncomfortable for me to even say.
Yeah. Yeah. You're bumping up against your comfort zone. And the more that you tell people, the more that you do it, the more that you do reels about what you're creating, the easier it'll get.
Yeah. I mean, you're right, but it is. It's outside my comfort zone.
That's exciting. So is it a devotional of sorts? Is it a story?
Well, I guess my thought was it could be kind of like an ebook, short and educational. Not necessarily a devotional, not a story necessarily, but just
cool.
Educational. Yeah.
And eventually that could be found on your Amazon author account.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking. But really, I'm just playing around with it right now. And I have learned so much. And I have found I definitely have that thirst and desire to understand and learn more. Like, that gets me excited.
Yeah. Yeah. So one idea could be following that joy.
Yeah.
Following that joy. What naturally are you excited about? Now I do know that desire can be created, right? Like you can think of a topic and whether you're interested in or not, you can go dive in and become interested, right? But you can also follow that joy. What are you naturally inclined to research about? I mean, I know months ago you were diving into the brain and you were really interested in learning about that. And so following that desire, doing some research, but then maybe having the end goal of a small ebook could be something to expand your hobbies list.
Yes.
Give you more brain space. Now, what's interesting though, is these topics, right, are oftentimes leading back to the healing journey of some sort.
Yeah. The title of what I have right now is Ephesians for the Hurting.
Okay.
So, I mean, it is still somewhat tied, but it's not my story. It is the healing. It is comforting and bringing peace. And
yeah. Does it give you brain space outside of your own hurt and pain?
Yeah. Yeah, it does. And I want to come back and I want to come back and write. Like, we got things that we're doing and I'm like, oh, I got all these things on my mind. I want to come brain dump and put it down. Like, it's exciting for me.
Okay. So you would consider that like another layer of you?
I would.
Okay.
And you know, if I was given the chance to speak outside, again, I'm totally okay sharing my story. I want to open blind eyes. Like, that's not me saying that's the old me. But also given the chance to speak about God and Jesus and how much I love them excites me. And yeah, you know, because when I do share my story, it's incredible that the conversations I have afterwards. It's hard too, though. Like, it is hard. It's draining and difficult, empowering. But you know, I'd love to have both at some point. Maybe that's a dream, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a great way to start, is following your joy, writing about things that interest you, continuing to do research and kind of pull that thread and see where that takes you.
So here's my thought process with all this. You have a survivor. Let's say she's a trafficking survivor. Let's say she gets out of trafficking and she's now in a safe house. And the safe house ends and now she's on her own. And obviously she needs to make money. And majority of jobs, not all, but majority of jobs will require things that will be extremely difficult for her due to PTSD and the trauma that she has. So what you do tend to lean on is your story as a way to hopefully make ends meet. What you often find is survivors going back to the life because of that's the only way they know how to make money. So expanding your brain to you are more than just your story, and but then you're still dealing with the trauma effects as well. How do you navigate that? How do you help a survivor financially take care of themselves and not make it all about their story?
It seems like the first thought I have is having a workplace that's understandable, that would give grace, that is not full of outside crisis coming in, right? But having a workplace where there is a clear, consistent job or task to be done in a supportive community. I know that when I was doing my therapy work, people would come in and they would want to get on disability because they didn't feel like they had the ability to work. Now, this was the people I'm thinking of are more major depression, things like that, not necessarily PTSD or trauma. But what I felt like was, you know what? Having a job, even if it's a part-time job, would probably support your depression because it gives you something to do. It gives you community. It gives you, a place to be, an accomplishment, and all of these types of things. And so finding a position where you can have a clear role, but then also supportive community would probably be really beneficial to survivors. Now,
Yeah, I agree.
the tricky part is finding that. And sometimes you may
Right.
have to, try a few places to really see, but.
Well, and yeah, so what's tricky with that is sometimes sharing your trauma with a workplace can make you more vulnerable to, like, depending on who you're, if you're sharing it with a psychopath and you don't know it, you know what I mean? Like, it could be dangerous in one sense. I do remember hearing, and maybe if I can find it, we can put it in the show notes, that there is an whether it's I think it's a website maybe or a group that has trauma-informed businesses for survivors, where they are trained to be able to take in survivors of extreme trauma and give them a job. And there's like a list of different jobs and businesses that you can contact. And I think they're trying to get more and more on that list because trauma-informed businesses is important.
And I don't know that you would need to sit down with a boss and say, "Hey, here's my whole story." I think you would
No.
need the idea would be to say, "I have some PTSD, and some of these things are triggering for me, and this is what I need to do when I'm feeling emotionally overwhelmed," or something
Yes.
like that.
And let and somebody's going to hire you.
Well, a goal would be you'd already be hired.
Already.
You'd already be hired, but you would be able to say, "I get overwhelmed when this happens, and so I will just take a 5-minute break, calm myself down, and I'll come back." Or that type of thing. So that involves self-awareness and
Yes.
that involves good communication.
And vulnerability. Because I mean, in your mind, you're thinking, why would they keep me hired on if I come in there and say, hey, this is, I guess the more confident you are in it,
Well, because the alternative is you don't say anything and you just have a freak
it's
out
suffer
and
in
run away.
silence.
And
Yes. Yes.
that wouldn't be any better
You're not wrong. But yeah, whenever you've already experienced abandonment or neglect or whatever, whenever your story has been shared, you are let you don't want to share it with the job.
The
It's
other
dangerous.
idea would be instead of telling your job, make sure you have your a friend or somebody else that you can call in the midst of a crisis moment, or and you have a plan in place. The biggest thing is for you to feel like if this upsetting thing happens and I start to feel triggered or I start to XYZ, I know what to do and I've got support of people around me.
Yeah. Because let's say I go to a school and they're like, yes, we want you to be a substitute teacher. That's great. Wonderful. We've been needing them. And then I come back the next day, hey, just FYI, I may have a huge panic attack in the middle and a flashback of don't, I'm just gonna walk away from the students for just 5 minutes and just and gather myself. And I mean, they're gonna be like, okay, hold on. Maybe you're not meant for this job.
So what would you do?
What do you mean? Not
So
tell them.
let's say you
Probably.
go, what's that?
I'd probably not tell them.
Okay. So then let's say you have a flashback in the middle of your afternoon and you feel it starting to come and it's getting emotional. What do you do?
I probably continue trying to function as best I can in that moment. And then as soon as I get home, I'll probably fall apart and crash and.
Use your supports, use your skills.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just being real here. Like it would be really hard. I could do it, absolutely, depending on the flashback. I could absolutely do it. But I also know the rest of the evening would be extremely difficult, and that's when I need to be present as a mom. See, I've thought through all this,
Yep.
not in a positive way.
Well, so that's one option, right? Is to not tell work and make sure you've got supports at home, you're using your skills at home, that kind of thing. That outside of your workplace, you know what to do to handle it. The alternative is if you are feeling like it's something you can't push through, to know that there's somebody safe there that you can talk to. Whether you go to the counseling office or whether you go to the principal and you say, you know what, I'm going to have to bow out this afternoon. I'm so sorry. But to have those options and to know what your options are is helpful.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. And the more you do it and the more good days you have, the
Yes.
stronger you'll feel. Like we have one of our survivors who she has to stand up and kind of give these presentations each week. And, in the beginning, she had so much anxiety with it. And she went through our 90-day program. And, I think part of it was our program and this the support of her being able to say out loud to somebody, this is hard and this is what I struggle with. But she continued to do it. And now, so far, she's not had a panic attack in the midst of it. And she's like, I don't know what changed, but it's all of a sudden like I'm okay now.
Yeah, action is king. The way you grow your comfort zone is by doing the thing outside your comfort zone. And so, the way for you to build your brain outside, like brain space outside of your story, is by doing things outside of your story. So, whether that is being a mom and hanging out with mom friends and not necessarily giving them your whole backstory unless it's needed or comes up. Or, you start writing on talking about a ton of different various topics. Or you start substitute teaching or doing art classes or whatever that give you the time and space to build your identity and your comfort zone and give you brain space outside of this like survivor and healing story.
Yeah. I mean, all of that sounds great and kind of exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah, not losing who I am or where I came from, but
Yeah.
building on it.
Building on it. Absolutely. And so, for those who are survivors who are listening, I think step one, right, is to get out of fight or flight mode and start the healing process. Because if you're consistently triggered, right, that's a clue that there's more healing to do. If you don't feel safe in your own skin, in your home, in your relationships, like that's another clue that there's healing to do. And so starting your own healing journey, but then you'll get to a point too where you go, what else am I about? And you get to rediscover yourself in new fun ways.
Yes, and that's what I want every survivor to hear. You're more than just the yuck of your story. And even if we were to look back, my hope is that you would have memories that aren't all bad of who, and that's all of that makes up who you are today. All of that is a part of your story, the good and the bad. And so, you're right, clickbait, sometimes people want to hear the yuck, but you're more than that. And yeah, I want everybody to know that, even myself.
Absolutely. Well, thank you guys for being a part of our discussion today. We really didn't know where this was going to take us, but it is another step in the healing journey is to start building your life, not just a place of survival. So you're at that place, Rachel, where you're like, all right, how do I thrive here? And really start to put in roots and blossom, right? And so you get to try all these new things to give yourself brain space and expand that comfort zone and see what other talents God can use.
Ah, that's exciting. I think that's God's plan.
Yeah. All right, you guys. Well, thank you for hanging out with us today. We so appreciate you. I'm going to end with an I declare. A couple things to note. If you are interested in hearing Rachel's story, hearing her speak, inviting Stapsis to come and speak to your community, then please reach out to us. The information is in the show notes. If you are a survivor and you want to connect with us, whether you're, you know, currently in fight or flight mode and in that crisis mode and are looking for survivors to walk the healing journey with you, we are starting a new program in the next few months called Reflecting Ownership. And so certainly reach out if you're interested in being a part of that. We'll have another 90-day U-turn round come next year, as well as a retreat. So a lot of fun things are brewing over here as we help as many survivors as possible, not only get out of fight or flight mode, move into rest and digest on the healing journey, but then also start to expand themselves and start to live, as we say, what in living color. You're wearing your red shirt today.
Yes, I am.
All right. Well, I'm going to end with an I declare. I declare that I am calm and peaceful. I do not let people or circumstances upset me. I rise above every difficulty, knowing that God has given me the power to remain calm. I choose to live my life happy, bloom where I am planted, and let God fight my battles. This is my declaration, and this is my declaration for you. Have an awesome week, you guys, and we'll see you next week. Thank you so much for listening to this powerful episode of Stop Suffering in Silence. If you are interested in booking Rachel to speak at your school, your church, or on your podcast, then please email openblindeyes@protonmail.com. If you are interested in sponsoring a survivor on their healing journey and would like to donate to Stapsis, then please check out the link in the description box or show notes below, or you can email stapsis@protonmail.com. And finally, if you are currently suffering in silence, or you know somebody who is, whether they're dealing with a current trauma or one from the past, then we will always recommend that you reach out to your local resources and find a counselor that you can trust, because nobody is meant to suffer alone. Have an amazing week, and thank you for being here.